As we begin discussing chapter 14, this is potentially one of the most important chapters that we cover this semester. In this chapter, we'll be discussing properties of acids, bases, and salts, and how we calculate their pHs. And this is such an important chapter because acid-base reactions are one of the broadest reaction types in all of chemistry. So even for those of you going on to take organic chemistry, you'll see that they will be discussing acid-base reactions. So we start with a couple of foundational questions, some examples of acids that you can think of in your home. One of the most common sources of acids that you'll find would be any beverages that we drink. Most beverages and most drinks that we consume are going to be acidic. It's actually very rare to have any drink be a basic solution. Most of the common examples we think of are juices, citric acid, orange juice, things like that. Obviously, lemon juice are very acidic. Coffee and tea are also acidic beverages. Vinegar is a very common one that is used in the home. Vinegar is more formally known as acetic acid. You should be familiar with that formula, CH3COOH, one option of how we write that formula. Examples of bases in your home. This would be most of your cleaning products. So think of something like Windex. That distinct odor that Windex has is attributed to ammonia. Bleach is a very strong base. And so again, most of your cleaning products, soaps, things like that, all tend to be basic. So we want to make sure we understand how to identify acids and bases in lab. Again, in this chapter, we'll be calculating pHs, and it's helpful to remember that acids have low pHs between 0 and 7. 7 is technically neutral, so technically this would go to 6.9. In lab, we can test solutions with litmus paper. So if I want to test an acid, I would actually use blue paper. And if my solution is an acid, that paper would turn red. We can use the most accurate option, and that would be a pH meter. This is an electronic device that measures the electrical conductivity of a solution and translates that into a pH value. Bases, of course, will have a high pH value. Again, 7 is neutral, so 7.1 would be the beginning point for anything basic. Again, we can use litmus paper in lab. So if I want to test a base, I would want to use red paper. And if that solution is a base, my paper would turn blue. Or, of course, we can use the more accurate pH meter. So some visuals of different ways that we can measure pH. This first one is a picture of a pH meter. So if you are taking 152 lab at GCC, this is something similar to what you'll use. You can also get a less accurate pH meter, like this one in the upper right. My husband and I actually bought one from Amazon for about 10 or 15 bucks. It actually only goes to one decimal place, so it is much less accurate than what we use in lab. But if you're curious about what you're consuming at home, a good option from Amazon. You are familiar with using indicators in titration experiments. So indicators are solutions that will turn colors at different pH values. This picture is just showing different colors of solutions based on their pH values. You're most familiar with phenolphthalein, which is colorless in acidic solutions and turns pink in basic solutions. And we can use a step up from litmus paper, something called pH paper, where same idea, it's a piece of paper, you drop a solution onto it, and then you can evaluate the color of the pH paper to determine a more accurate pH value than indicators. And an image I like to leave you with, just some examples of everyday things you're familiar with and their pH values. But really the reason that I love this image is because of this one. the legs diving into the water. And the only thing I've come up with is that they're trying to show the pH of hair remover, which is about a pH of 12. So something like Nair. But again, just to give you an idea of what substances and their pH values are, this is a great resource.